Okay, thank you so much for coming, everyone, and welcome to today's webinar all about data science. So I'll do a formal introduction now. So my name's Jackson, I'm from UniSA International, and I'm specifically responsible for the STEM faculty, which includes, of course, the Master of Data Science, which we're talking about today. I've got a couple of colleagues joining me here today. I've got Manu, my sidekick today, helping me out with the admin of today's webinar. Thanks so much, Manu. Manu is from our regional team. Some of you may have met him in parts of South Asia before, which is the region that he looks after. And of course, we've got the man of the moment, who is Dr. Nick Fewster-Young, the program director for the Master of Data Science, who's really here to tell us all about the program. So just a little bit of housekeeping. Thanks so much, everyone, for muting yourselves and keeping your video off, unless you really wanted to have your face shown as part of the recording. But we are recording it today, so we'll send it around later as well. Basically, there is, of course, the chat function. So we do want this is live, so we do want this to be as helpful as possible to you. And if you have any specific questions, please feel free to put them up onto the chat so we can answer them. I'll keep a monitoring of the chat going, and I'll jump in and ask questions as they come through, especially if you've got questions for Nick. But otherwise, we will try to answer as many of them as possible at the end of the session. So I'm just going to mention about one thing coming up, especially if any of you are actually already is holding an offer or has applied for UniSA, in particular, Master of Data Science. And that's an event that we have coming up on the 14th and 15th of May called Hey UniSA. So today's webinar is very much about data science. But if you're wanting to know more sort of general questions about starting your studies with us in July this year, maybe like what it's like to study online or what the situation is with visas, or if you'd actually like to have a one-on-one chat with someone specifically from the international office, we'll be running this two-day event with all sorts of different useful sessions, hearing from student ambassadors and current students, as well as being able to attend these one-on-one chat sessions as well. So do check out the website there and register or book yourself a one-on-one appointment, and we're happy to chat even in more detail then. But I'll be controlling the decks up here, but I'm going to hand over to Nick to get going with talking to us all about this program of data science, which we will be offering this July, which is really exciting. So Nick, straight over to you.
Oh, thank you, Jackson. It's great to be here, and welcome everyone to our little webinar on data science. So to kick us off, I want to start thinking about, and then you guys think about IT. Everyone knows what it is. For instance, it can be broken up into, I guess, three streams we start to think about is computer science, which UniSA, we have a lot of different bachelors that you can actually take throughout this at our university, and information systems and technology, which can be masters of IT, which sort of sits on the left and the right. And now let's start to think about combining everything. And then I should also say, I guess there's another strand, which is mathematics. And we combine all this together and we come up with the Master of Data Science, or data science as it is, which is to make informed decisions using data in everyday life. And this is obviously then related to businesses. So businesses want to make informed decisions about what they're doing. And as we know, data is all around us. And there's so many different applications out there. So for instance, we also have an undergraduate program and a postgraduate program. And as Jackson was saying, yes, we will be offering this in SP5, which starts in July this year. So that's exciting. So there's many different applications out there, and we've got a few applications to show you. Thank you, Jackson. And it's literally all around us. So we've got things like loyalty programs, you've got traffic light sequencing. You know, sometimes when you're just driving down the road and you go, why is every time we're going, like driving down the road, why are the lights changing in different sequencings? Like the roads are all controlled, actually, in fact, using data and actually map and different algorithms. And I always find this fascinating because, you know, in peak hour traffic, for instance, we're driving, sometimes we see different sequencings on different roads, and it's quite interesting. Satisfaction systems or ratings, when you're buying products online as well. So you always see there's a different, maybe 5-star rating. And this can all be used as marketing tools and to inform our decisions of what we should be buying. So underlying that is data science, okay? Data and then using science statistics to make informed decisions about what we're doing. Believe it or not, it comes up in crime all the time, in forensics as well. So statistics is a very powerful tool. And obviously data is a very powerful, it's all around us, but it's a very powerful resource for us to use. And even earthquake prediction software. So there's so many different things out there in the world. And this is just 6 different examples. You can keep going. And if we start thinking about industries now, the 3 biggest industries out there is banking and finance, engineering, which we're thinking about, okay, we could be looking at preventative measures. So let's say you've got a windmill, right? You know, we want to have more natural resources, gain more electricity through windmills. The cost of producing one windmill is phenomenal. However, it all has different little parts to it. So if we come up with an idea and go, okay, well, we use data science, like the data and the science, and go, okay, this is when that particular part is going to fail, then we know when to replace it. Instead, if we don't, we just go, oh, when it breaks, well, that's, you know, that can be hundreds and hundreds of thousands of dollars when it could just be $50 to replace. Okay, so using our knowledge of data and science, we can come up with all these great informed decisions what we should be doing. Finally, healthcare is one that is the 3rd biggest as well. And that's growing faster than ever. Okay, you imagine all the hospitals out there, all the healthcare, the nurses, the aged care, childhood, etc. We're all starting now to use data. Okay, it could be as simple as we're seeing at the moment, predicting COVID, right? That's something that we've been doing recently, obviously, and we're starting to find, okay, when should we have the vaccines out? How is the trajectory looking? Obviously, there's so much unknown about this, but was, you know, I think pretty good, reasonable attempt at finding out decent solutions here. And that's looking at the growth of COVID and the different number of cases we're having every day and when will it drop off and when should we start opening up borders, etc. And, you know, in Australia, I think we've done a really good job. Most of Australia is all open now. So, you know, we've used data to help us actually engineer and create different softwares, etc., to be able to battle that disease. So that's great. Now, I've told you all these applications to motivate you. Let's talk about the program itself. Okay, so this is the Master of Data Science program that we've constructed. And these are the courses which we believe that are the most important for you right now. Now, as years go on, they do change. We do update them because we want them to be relevant to you. So in the first year, first semester, we start off and go, okay, you know what's really important? Data. Let's start thinking about big data, which is, it's like YouTube, right? The amount of data that we take from YouTube and Google, et cetera, is phenomenal. It's updating every milliseconds that are out there. So that data has been collected. It's massive. How do we use it? So we talk about the basics or foundations. From there, we start thinking about how does that relate to businesses? So we connect that in as well. So we look at business case studies there when they're using big data, the pros and the cons. And there's a little bit of dashboards that are in there as well in that course. Now, you can't have data without some sort of programming, right? So we thought, great, let's put in some statistical programming, which is using a software called R. Now, you may have heard of this before. It's very powerful statistical software, which is open source. What does that mean? That means that it's free, okay? Anyone can download it, anyone can use it. However, you know, as a mathematician came up with it, you know, it does require a bit of teaching and a bit of patience. So it is becoming one of the most common softwares to use now, because now you can actually create programs within it. I'm sure many of you, if you've gone through an IT degree all around the world, you're starting to go, okay, well, they're starting to teach me about Python. And Python's the next part of it as well. So in that course is Python and R. And then in the first year, we look at 2 particular directive electives. And you choose any 2 of these. Ideally, myself would actually be picking these 2 for you. directed in the sense that I'll pick the best ones that I feel will make you accomplish your degree and have the most round or most round set up for the rest of the degree as well. And by the time you finish, you're nice, well-rounded, and you're quite confident in data science. We move into the second semester, which is all about descriptive and predictive analytics using many different methods. Research methods, data visualization, which is really important as well. And then finally, we get into the second year of the program. And in the second year of the program, we actually start going, branching off and start looking at a lot of business applications in social media, customer analytics. And one of our favorite subjects is the data science professional development, which is actually bringing in an industry, trying to bring in an industry partner where you work on different on a particular project. And you're actually utilizing the skills that you've learned in your previous courses throughout, try and solve a problem. That's been quite popular. And then finally, at the end of the day, the very, very last semester here, we get into some advanced techniques. And in this very last one here, this really big one that we've got here is a capstone professional project. And this is where, instead of the data science professional, where the person gives you the project and we look at different things here, and I guess I'll give you an idea of what we've looked at recently. So we've looked at education, we've looked at our own university and how students are actually going. That's one project. Another was that we looked at recently was Google AdWords. Okay, that was another one, looking at AdWords and predicting price that we set out. And another one that was recently done as well was about anxiety. And that can be around anything. In particular here, it was about statistics. The capstone professional project is actually diving into something where we actually put you in a team and we send you off and we go, here's the industry partner and an academic supervisor. And you're all doing different projects, completely different. So this is quite, this gives you industry facing. This gives you quite a bit of exposure out into the real world. Now, data science at UniSA in particular, like I said before, the two main programs we use is R and Python. Now, you might be familiar with AWS, which is a database system. We also have SAS involved too. Now, SAS pops up in about 60% of our courses. And by doing all the courses and going through, you actually will get a certification. So you'll get a separate certificate, right? Not just the Master of Data Science when you finish. You actually get a SAS certification and what they call a badge. So you'll get this little badge which says, I'm SAS certified. Now, anyone doesn't know what SAS is? SAS is a statistical program allowing us to do different types of statistical tests on data, okay? It's been around for a very long time and is actually pretty, I would say, out of anything out there, probably the most prestigious because it's been around the longest. So it's nice to have that bit of accreditation, especially when you're applying for jobs and going through. And I wanted to talk also about that data science professional development. So we have a little slide here that we thought was quite interesting. It is really all about that one industry partner that comes along, one challenge that you've got. And one of the particular challenges that was a few years ago was actually Port Adelaide Football Club, which is a very big thing in Adelaide. Okay, so football or AFL, I think people live and breathe it here. So to be able to get students to actually work on a project about determining attacking midfield and different strategies to win the game, looking at different techniques such as clustering, they were actually able to come up with different tactics to actually provide Port Adelaide. Now, it always depends on every season, every game, you know, there's a lot of variability there. But this was great, and this gave one group the ability to come up with a solution to that particular problem and offer different variety of solutions too, which was great. Now, where will you be working in UniSA? I guess that's probably something you're thinking about now. Like, what's the campus look like? What's the teaching rooms? Well, the teaching rooms, we try to make them now as collaborative as possible. So you are working in groups. You can work by yourself individually as well. But we'd like to sort of give you an idea here of the space. Okay, so this is one of our new buildings that we have at UniSA. It's called the Jeffrey Smart Building. And we run half our courses in the city. So you're nice and close to everyone. You can get in touch with different industry partners. And then the other half of this program actually runs out in Mawson Lakes, which is just outside, which is actually a technology park. So there's a lot of different companies out there which are all related to technology. Some of the industry partners that we engage with, and you will be engaging with as well, and it's not obviously limited to this, are the following. So some of the ones we've had before are the SAPOL, which is the South Australian Police, Fuji Xerox, which is a printing company. I'm sure many of you have heard of them. SA Water, which is our water distribution company here in SA in South Australia. Different banks, different consulting companies, power networks, real estate, mining companies. The list goes on and on and on. Public sector, health. The list is not just limited to this. This is just what we've worked in the past, and we thought these were some of the best examples to show you. So you really are looking across nearly every single industry in South Australia, and if not in Australia. So, you know, it's quite a broad spectrum. So I feel that's some good motivation, right, to study data science. Now, some of the projects, okay, that we some of the projects that we have, we like to think about, say, data science professional development and the capstone project as being practical learning experiences. Now, the very final one that we do, which is the capstone project, is a final year industry project. And it does cover, you do see other people from different IT and postgraduate, okay? But the idea is essentially to get you out there working with these different types of companies, okay? And yeah, it only runs for one semester. It's a short, very short, but it gives you that exposure, which is great. And experience is one of the key things that we believe everyone should have, right? Get out there, work in the real world, work with people that you might be working with in the future. There are always the opportunities for internships which come up. And if you work hard, then you will get there, okay? But we can't promise that to everyone, fortunately. But, you know, we try our best. We have a few students that I thought would be really nice to just go or talk about. So these are some of our past students that we've had here at UniSA, and they've accomplished great things. So these are students who've done internships and have gone on further and now have proper jobs, okay? They're actually working here. So Nick Sewell, he graduated in 2016 with the Master of Data Science. He did the Capstone Professional Project with My Budget. Now, and he's now full-time permanent position there, which is great, right? So this could be you, all right? Another student that we have is I've always struggled to say his name.
Abhishek, I think it is.
He has probably been one. Yeah, Jackson?
Abhishek, Jump in.
Abhishek?
Yeah.
Always try to say his name. But he's probably one of the most, I guess he's probably one of the most, would you say, accomplished out of our graduates, Jackson?
Yeah, quite a high profile one, this one. You'll see him on the website, yeah. Actually.
Yeah, so we promote him quite a bit because we're very proud of him. So he's now got a full-time consulting position and job at Ensign Australia, which is great, right? So another one of our, I guess, high-achieving students that come out of this degree who was an international student, okay? So, which is great. Tu Tran is another student that we have as well. He finished in 2018, so not that long ago now, and now he's working as an analyst programmer. And he works for a company which is a bit like fintech, okay? So they do a lot of financial marketing, etc. So, and we have, I think we one more, Jackson, don't we? One more student. So I can't pronounce the name.
Aradhana, yeah, another hard one for you. Aradhana, yep.
Yeah, I need the phonetics, you know, that's yeah. What I need. She was actually one of our UniSA International Student Ambassadors as well, and she's a business analyst at ActiveOps. So now you've probably seen, like, we put their job titles in there of different jobs they got. Now, none of them really say data science, okay? So that's something to be aware of, and I'll come back and talk to you about this in just a moment. And there's so many different types of jobs out there, okay? So we actually have a list, don't we, Jackson? All right, so it could be any one of these things. So if you jump on the internet and just Google these types of jobs, these are all the types of jobs that once you finish with the Master of Data Science, you could be going into, right? The skill set that you develop in the program is very broad. And the reason being is because you could do all these jobs, all right? So you'll be able to do any one of these that we have up here. Some you'll probably do better than others because that's what you gravitate towards. You may do the program and say, oh, I'm actually really good at statistics. I'm a really good C++ programmer. I might be really good with databases. So you could be going all these different directions. And when you're doing these projects as well in the final year project, usually when you team up with 3 or 4 other people, you'll find that they have different skills as well. And you sort of mend and blend together and create a phenomenal team to be able to produce a grand project with these industry partners. And that's how we say. So you could become a deployment engineer, a data analyst, which is one of the most common, or consultant. You'll notice that we've got PwC there. There are many other consulting companies in Australia as well, such as Ernst & Young. Graduate data officer as well. We saw this one of these jobs here, the Department of Correctional Facilities. We thought, well, this is an interesting one, right? So you could actually work for the government in correctional services, right? As a data officer, right? That's pretty cool. You can also work in a bank too. So it doesn't just mean you're gonna work in correctional services. You could be working in a bank, you could be working for different financial institutions as well. Another thing is risk, and also, we'll talk about this in just a moment, is you could be working for an insurance company. So lots of insurance companies love to hire data scientists. It's all about using data that they're getting from their clients and then informing what they should be doing. So for instance, how do I set my premium? How do I know when someone's gonna go, gonna make a claim or default on a loan? Default on a loan, if anyone's not aware, that means that they can't pay something back, so they miss a payment. You could just become a data scientist, a business analyst, C++ programmer in gaming. The jobs are endless. Okay, so there's such a wide variety out there. You don't necessarily just become a data scientist. You may become any one of these things and many more. Okay, so that's just something to keep in mind if you do the program and you do finish, don't just search data scientist on the internet. All right.
Nick, I might just add one thing there, just to clarify that this list here is not just a list of what you could be. This is a list of where our actual international students who have graduated from this program have now gone on and done. So this is like an actual evidence list of the jobs that international graduates of our Master of Data Science are now doing. Just to be fully clear on that, which is great.
Yeah. Yeah. And you'll see that there's, like, as we were talking before about two trainees, he's become analyst programmer at GBST. And we've also got Adriana, which is she's an active ops business analyst. So you can see that these are, as Jackson's saying, these are actual graduates that we've had finish who now work in all of these different places. So I think that's great. And thank you, Jackson, for putting this all together.
No worries.
But it's not just limited there as well. And you know what, we can also talk about IT careers, different job outlooks. So you'll be able to see here, this is how much someone actually starts earning. Okay. Now this is just taken from joboutlook.gov.au, which is just basically scraped it off the website. It's not doesn't mean that it's 100% accurate, I'll say that now, but it gives you a rough idea of what data scientists are earning in these particular jobs, okay? So we've picked out top five that we can find, and you can see from, as we're going through here, we've got a little time on July, September, and December each year. The last time it was recorded was December 20, which is not too long ago, actually. What's that, 3 months ago? So, or four, 5 months ago now. And it's giving an indication here of how, or how strong, or the how many people are actually looking for these types of jobs. Okay, so the availability. So you're going to see most of them all just on the increase at the moment, which is great. So we hope this will continue, and that means that there will be lots of jobs out there for you guys as well. That's why we want to teach data science. We want to teach IT. We want to get more involved in it. And we hope we'll get more students like you guys interested in such a promising career, in my opinion. Oh, I'm running out of breath, Jackson.
You're doing well. It's good. Keep pushing through.
As we said, as I don't know if Jackson mentioned before, but this is, you know, if you have any questions at all that you want us to answer, we're more than happy to answer any of your questions. And don't be afraid. Don't be afraid to put anything in the chat. We'll make this, doesn't have to be completely formal. IT companies that actually have an Adelaide base here. So one of the biggest ones that we have here is Santos. You might be aware of it, but Santos is a huge mining and, what's the other thing, mining and, Jackson, was it?
Oil and gas for them.
Mining and resource.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oil, gas, mine, it's basic resources, all about Australian resources, I think.
Mm.
Yeah. So we've got the space agency as well, which is actually starting up. And on the next slide, we're actually going to show you where they're actually situated. But yeah, we have many different things. MIT has come over as well. So they've got a little hub. You've got Sony, Technicolor, and DXC technology as well. So on the next slide.
Even before we go there, sorry, I've realized that I need to update this slide because we've just had an announcement that Google is going to be starting headquarters, as well as I think Amazon is also coming into this same.
Yes, they are.
Right location as well. So yeah, that will be updated, but that's an exciting piece of news for you all. Sorry, Nick. Back to you.
No, that's all right.
Lot 14, tell us about it.
Yeah. Well, this is where Google's going to be, right? And Amazon and space. Well, space is there now. You actually see NASA is there as well. So they've got actually a small hub there. So it's all happening. Lot 14, they're turning this into a massive data scientist hub, pretty much. And it's located here right in the middle of the city. So you can see there's an Adelaide Oval, and the city is essentially encompassed by these parklands. Okay. And then you've got the ocean out there, and there's beaches out there too. So, you know, when you want to go for a swim, just go down there. It's not too far away. You can even see the airport on this picture. So it's such a condensed space in the middle, and it's the city sprawls out. And all the industries, all the big names are in here, but not limited to it as well. They actually span out and they go out into the countryside as well. Okay, so it's quite a sprawling industry. But you can see we want everyone to be in Lot 14. We're trying to focus it. And if you go further up, you'll see Adelaide Biomed City that we've put in there, Royal Adelaide Hospital. There's actually another one here called the SAMRI, which is a health institute, which does all research as well, and MOD as well, which is a actual data scientist's dream, where we use data to actually visualize different things happening in the world. So all of this around here is pretty much where it's happening in Adelaide. I'll mention one thing while we on this slide, just to, before I hand it over to Jackson, is that we do have opportunities which do come up for internships. And one of the recent ones that we actually did get for students was actually to work at MOD. So that one is currently, obviously, we've just posted that one, and that will go to a data scientist student that's here in the current program now. they may come up in the future, and they're always competitive based. However, they do exist. There are opportunities out there, and we try and give you the most opportunities that we possibly can, that we can find. And same with the government. And only as this Lot 14 grows, means there can only be more opportunities out there.
Beautiful.
Jackson, I'm going to hand it over to you.
Sure thing.
To tell them all about fees.
Yeah, entry and fees, all the things you guys might already know, things you guys might want to know. Before we do that, I'm actually going to launch into a bit of very, very basic data science and just get you guys all to answer a two-question survey, which I'm just going to launch now. We just want to know the profile of who's in on the session today. There's about 50 of you, so if you wouldn't mind just answering this this survey as soon as you can, fill this one out here. We have had a couple of questions coming in, so sorry I haven't got to those yet, but I think I'm going to direct them to Nick actually as well, and do remember to keep asking the questions. But what I'll do first of all, I'll explain while you're still filling out these surveys. I'll go to the next slide and I'll just do a quick recap slash explanation on what our entry requirements and fees are. So Master of Data Science, basically it's a 2-year program as standard with Australian master's level degrees. The price per year in Aussie dollars is $34,800 per year. For 2020 and 2021, we have maintained that fee and have not had a fee increase in light of COVID. Our 2022 fees are not yet released, but we do anticipate that that those prices should stay very much the same. So $34,800 per year. We've got two intakes as standard for Australia. So February and of course the upcoming intake, which is in July. Now the key point that we need to talk about, which is of course the white elephant in the room, well, not that much of a white elephant, it's the obvious thing we all know, which is that of course the Australian border is currently closed. Of course this is really disappointing because we know that you all want to come to Australia. We want you to come to Australia. I myself and Manu, and I know Nick as well, are missing traveling to all of your different countries of the world to see you and eat your amazing food and all this kind of thing. But in the meantime, of course, I think the really, really good thing about the Master of Data Science is that this is a program that has always been available 100% externally, 100% online. And so it does mean that you can actually start your studies online. And the best part is that our online price is cheaper. We have a flat rate at UniSA of online studies of $2,875 per course, per subject. This works out to be about Australian $23,000 per year. And this basically means it's a 33% saving on what you would otherwise be paying face to face. So we say start online, transfer later when the borders open. So while the borders are still closed, you can enjoy a 33% saving for as much of the data science program as you wish to study, or as you can study while borders closed, if that makes sense. As it says here, you've probably already read it, entry is a bachelor degree in IT or mathematics, and your application will actually go via Nick himself, because this is a proper, as Nick's explained, it is a fully comprehensive data science program. It's not a loose IT with some data analytics. It is a proper data science program. So it does need to make sure that you've got that IT or mathematics background. English requirements are standard, 6.5 IELTS, 6 reading, 6 writing, and we do accept TOEFL and PTE as well. But Nick, while we're on this, so we've had a couple of questions around these backgrounds. Actually, I might just mention one for those of you tuning in from India, where you have another element around backlogs. Basically, from the 4-year degrees that you'd be likely to be coming from, we allow a maximum of 12 backlogs from that. So there is some level for flexibility, but with some specific requirements around GPA. So as a general rule, maximum backlogs is 12. If you're not from India, just ignore what I said because that doesn't apply to you, but that's the main point there, which I know there's a lot of people on here from there. So, Nick, we have had a few questions, as I said.
Seen them, yeah.
Oh, you can see them as well. Great, yeah. Like, how about this one at the bottom there? Yeah. Prerequisites, yeah.
Yeah, so I'll answer. There's two big ones here I can see. So Rita, you've asked a question here. Can students from a non-technical background like humanities apply for this program? And the answer is it can be possible, yes. However, you need to, say if you're doing a non-technical program like humanities, you can still take technical courses inside of it. So let's say, or for instance, let's say you've worked as a data analyst, and you've been doing all these sort of technical things, but your original degree might be in humanities. We do have pathways that can be accepted for this as well. So my recommendation is either A, you have extensive idea of A, mathematics and IT to be able to go in and go, okay, well, I know what databases are. I know what I can do statistics, or I can do mathematics to university level, and those sort of things. You can email us and ask us, well, do you think I'm going to fit or not? But in most of the times, or you have a very extensive industry background, okay? So it's unlikely that someone who's come from humanities would be great for the program, but doesn't mean you're out of the running. It is always, as Jackson was saying, it is that actually case-by-case basis. So I review every application that comes through, and it's either I look at every single thing on there, for instance, every course that you've done at university, to what are you doing now? Are you working? Where are you? You know, sometimes there's a statement there as well that you need to produce. The other question was, what are the prerequisites? And this sort of ties into what I was saying before. Most computer science engineers have most of the prerequisites ready to go. So what does that mean? It means that we want to see that you've done at least, you know, a good, I would like to say 40% computer science in that degree. And then inside your engineering, we want to see, well, you've done about another 20%, which is mathematics. Okay, so you want to understand, I want to know linear algebra, calculus, things like this, bit of statistics. And if you've done all that, then great. And can we jump back to that slide with the program?
The structure. Yeah, sure. Yeah.
So that would give them an idea.
Here we go.
So this one here, you see that there's these two directive electives here. You know, you might come in a bit light on the math side. You might have done more IT at home. Well, we'd be going, okay, well, why don't you do both math subjects? So there's subjects and there's two IT subjects. So you might say, oh, go do two math subjects. You might come in really strong mathematically. And we might say, okay, well, but you're weak IT. So we go, oh, well, why don't you do two IT courses? When you get down to the second semester, the maths and the IT, it all comes in. So if you're not up to that speed yet, then you're going to be in a bit of a problem. But the idea is that this first semester makes you quite well-rounded for the rest of the degree. Okay, so prereqs, there is no particular prereqs except for the ones that Jackson mentioned regarding English as well.
Yeah.
And also the idea is that you've done, I like to think of it as a good 60% combined in your degree of computer science or IT and mathematics. I think that's, were there any other questions there?
Yeah, beautiful. I think a few others, we're getting some stuff about scholarships, which Manu, thank you. You've just sent us the scholarship info, but I'm also going to clarify what our scholarships are. So I'll jump back on here. go through here. All right, so scholarships, everybody wants to know about scholarships. So basically, and sorry, while I ask this, if you haven't yet answered the poll, if you could please do that. We still have a few more people to answer, so check it out. Thanks to those of you who have answered the survey already. So let's talk about scholarships. So we've got two main types of scholarships at UniSA. One is the International Merit Scholarship. This is 15% off the whole degree. It's automatically assessed. So if you are eligible for this scholarship, we will provide this scholarship to you as part of your offer letter. You do have to study 2 years. That's fine because the Master of Data Science is 2 years. This gives you some general idea of those entry requirements as per many of the different kinds of sort of entry. Now, ignore the bachelor side. This is our standard scholarship slide here. So look at the master side there. We're basically looking for you to have the equivalent of a UniSA credit. That means 5 out of 7 in our grading system. In other parts of the world, we're looking for around sort of like, it often can get called first class, first division, 60%, 6.5 out of 10. It does vary from country to country. I'm just giving you a few sort of examples, but that's the ballpark you'd be looking at for that that International Merit Scholarship, 15% off the whole degree. To clarify one thing, of course, just before I mentioned our 33% saving for the online subjects. So when you're studying online, this International Merit Scholarship does not apply because you'll already be receiving quite a discounted price. But once the borders open and then you come to Australia, then we would apply the Merit Scholarship if you were eligible for that based on your bachelor degree qualifications. So that's what that is. So that's the Merit Scholarship. We do have one other type of scholarship, which is called the Vice Chancellor's International Excellence Scholarship. This one is really for the cream of the crop students. And so basically you'd be aiming for a UniSA high distinction. Our system is a 7 out of 7. This doesn't mean you have to have 100%. This just means that you need to have the highest possible GPA. So we're often looking at those in the ballpark of 9 out of 10, 90-95% and above. So it is a very competitive scholarship. Now, Manu's link that he put up there will give you all the details on that, including the separate application form that you need to submit in order to be eligible for that. As you can see there, it's 50% off the whole degree, so a very attractive scholarship. So that will work out 50% off the entire degree. That is a bit of a summary of our scholarship situation. I'm just having a look, any other questions coming in here? Yes, I think we're getting a bit coming in around the start online side of things. So I know that everybody has this question of when are the borders going to open? This is really the golden question that we all want to know. We all want to know that it's soon, and we really don't know at this stage. So at this point in time, if you're applying, and I know that from the poll, some of you guys are applying for July this year, some of you are applying for Feb next year. So at this moment right now, if you apply for July, you will be receiving a start online offer with us. And that is just because we are assuming realistically the Australian border would not open by July. If somehow the border does open, then of course we will review and reissue that offer to be a face-to-face offer. But we're giving you that start online offer definitely for July. If you've applied for February next year, then at this stage we are giving you a face-to-face offer. That does not guarantee the borders will open. That is just what our system is currently doing. And then if we get clarification borders are not opening, we will change that to a start online offer. So for those of you who are worried about, look, how much will, if I take some of this online and then I transfer, what if the borders still aren't open? This is the best thing I just want to reiterate about the Master of Data Science is that this program is available 100% externally and always has been. So it's basically one of the best possible programs that you could be having to do online, even though you probably wish you didn't have to do it online. But it's great because it's already been designed. Nick, you know, jump in here, but like from the very beginning, it was designed as a program that can be taken, you know, by an Australian who's working and might be needing to study remotely from home or something like this if needed, right?
Yeah, and I'll just jump in there and say, well, yeah, it was also designed in the idea that We wanted to get people involved and they may be working full time. So the idea to have an external offering for when you can work on it in your own time was also there. So this degree was originally created fully online, in tangent with being face to face. So both offerings are there. And, you know, as Jackson said, if something happens and you can't, and you know, you can't fly, we can't do this face to face, you can still do it externally. So that's a big plus, a big winning point. And it's cheaper if you do it online.
But yeah, exactly. 33% saving, which is a great thing. So we are getting a few more questions on this kind of stuff. Just having a look quickly here. Good question, Rav G. If I start in July and borders open in October, can I continue the semester on live and arrive in Australia the next semester, Feb? So obviously this is sort of, everything's unprecedented. We hear the word unprecedented all the time. There will be certain rules around that. It's all to do with your Australian visa. We do have a link, in fact. I think Manu has just posted a bit up there. A few comments up. Take a look at that link because that's going to answer a lot of those specific questions as well around all the rules around starting online. Generally, the good thing is with the way that we are structuring the timing of the data science courses, it does mean that if the borders open, partway through the semester, you can actually come and then change from external classes into face-to-face classes. So that will be an option for those of you who are looking for that side of things.
Can I quickly just add,
please.
So with regards to the question from Rav G, the admissions team will be attaching an online study plan. Please do read your study plan carefully because there are comments on that regarding whether you can transfer your subject mid-semester to face-to-face or you need to continue in an online mode. So all of that information will be contained in your study plan.
A very good point, Manu. Thank you. That's great. That's why I have you here. are there any other questions that anyone has? Give you a few more minutes just in case. In the meantime, as you can see, I've thrown up the Hey UniSA slide just to remind you that that is our international virtual fair, where we'll have all sorts of sessions going on to help you to understand more around this sort of imminent July intake happening. So we did have, I think, thanks Manu, there was another question which was about final semester, one plans to drop CDC networks subject. So if we just quickly take a look. So this was a question, I'm assuming around the kind of, if you're in your final semester of say a bachelor degree and you've got a CDC networks subject, is that going to be a crucial element coming into the Master of Data Science? I think that's how I'm interpreting it. Is that right, Manu? Yeah. Does the question make sense, Nick? So I think a student is saying that they're thinking of potentially dropping a subject of CDC networks within their bachelor degree. Is that a crucial thing that would be, you would suggest don't drop that because that would be quite crucial for coming into the Master of Data Science?
I would definitely keep it. I wouldn't drop it. But again, like I was saying earlier, it also depends on what other courses you've done. So, if you've already done a course that has basically something similar to it, then it's fine. It's hard to say really without...
Based on that. On its own, yeah. I think probably I'd suggest from an admissions perspective, it's best for you to liaise with an education agent, submit an application, put this in the notes, say I'd like this to be considered. And as you know, the actual application will go through to Nick as a part of the process anyway. And that way then as part of the admission process, Nick can actually take a look at your whole transcript, look at the context of the other subjects you've done, and then advise on a proper sort of yes or no answer on that. So I'd say that's probably our best advice to give you.
Yeah, no, I agree. I mean, if it's a networks course, then it really comes down to, if it's a networks course in the sense of, oh, I'm going to go put like a physical network over here or something like that, then no, then that doesn't matter. You can drop that. But if it's definitely a software or programming networks, developing, you know, for instance, relational databases, then it's definitely important.
Yeah. Yeah, no, good one. We have another question here. This is actually quite a good one, Nick. Ravjit has asked me, I've joined July 2021 session, so welcome in advance, Ravjit. It's great to have you to join us. His question is, when can I get the books and study material? Do you want to tell us how that'll work, Nick? Because obviously it's online. Does he have to get books? I don't think he does, right?
No, so pretty much all the courses, there's no... You don't have to get the books. We'll give you recommended texts that you can get. And they can all be found, you know, basically once we've given you the study plan. If you go to the course, not the course website, I should say, there's a little course information website inside the program. I don't know if anyone has the link available.
That's all right. Maybe Manu, because I'm sharing screen, do you mind just grabbing the LMDS homepage and shooting through the URL? Manu will send it up for all of you guys.
Yep. So Manu will send it through. And if you just click through, you'll be able to click a course and go, okay, I'm taking that course. And it will give you the course content description. And then it will say, oh, here's the textbook that we might be using. We'll recommend a textbook for the course. But yeah, most of the notes and all of this stuff that we come up with won't be available till it actually starts. So you don't have to worry about anything till it actually kicks off. But if you want to get a bit of a head start, then there's no reason why you can't go off and buy the recommended textbook and start having a read.
No, good one. Thanks, Nick. I'm just going to actually share that screen because we can just take a look here. This is the homepage that Nick's talking about here, Master of Data Science. So you go through here, you can scroll down, and then here's where you'll see these exact course names that we were just mentioning in the PowerPoint slide from before. Say you wanting to know, oh, Big Data Basics, then you go through here, you click on that, that's the name of the actual course, and then it's giving you all the information about it, including the aim, the content, textbook, look, nothing's required for that, and then all the other details around that. So you can get a bit of a pre-idea by just clicking around based on that homepage onwards. For the website, which is great. And it's only once you actually are fully admitted as a student, then you'll receive that that email, which is all about like orientation, logging into your student system, getting your student ID, and then you go into the full environment that's all about the Learn Online environment. If you want to know more about all that and what that all looks like, I'm not going to share that today. We're going to do that all at the Hey UniSA Open Day coming up on 14th, 15th of May. So join that session because we'll have a whole session which is all about that. What does it look like to study online? Which is great. I reckon that that might just about wrap it up because we are just about out of time. Thank you so much to everyone who's joined the session today. Thank you so much, Nick. Really do appreciate you being here today. Anything else final you needed to or wanted to add at all, Nick?
Not really, but we look forward to seeing you all in July, we hope, and then in person come next year.
Yeah, absolutely. Sounds good.
We're pretty excited.
No, that's great. No, thank you. Thank you, Nick. Thanks, everyone. We do look forward to seeing you. As I mentioned, we've recorded today's webinar, so we'll shoot you around a link of the video. Thank you, Nick. Thank you, Manu. And yeah, have a lovely afternoon and evening wherever you are in the world. Thanks, guys.
Thanks, Jackson.
Bye.